Good morning, everyone, and welcome to a Christmas Saturday Disney.
Is that you, Dan, under there?
Oh, I just cut down the tree.
Pumpkin! Ho, 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 ho!
Good morning, good morning.
Merry Christmas!
Woo. You're jumping, you know, ahead, aren't you? It's not Christmas yet.
Close.
No, no, no. We've got a tree.
Yes.
We've got decorations.
We've got spirit.
Do we have stories?
Yeah, of course we do. We meet an Aussie BMX champion.
Oh, yeah.
The trans freezers.
Ooh,
what are they doing? And Dan plays gridiron.
Oh, baby.
Ho ho! Welcome back to Saturday Disney.
Hey guys, do you reckon we should put the tree on this side?
Yeah.
All right.
We're getting organised for Christmas. We have the carols cranked up.
We've got a couple of decorations. We will be needing some more.
Exactly. And we've got special Christmas cartoons. This is Hey Hey, they're the monkeys.
Three mad monkeys. Man, what a handful. We've got the Christmas spirit on Saturday Disney. See you soon for much more.
I think I definitely drew the short straw trying to untangle this mess. We have two old friends joining us right now. Remember Schnookums and Meat? Well, they're back with Jingle Bells, Something Smells.
Merry Christmas, boys, and hey, thanks for saving.
Hey, Dan.
Yeah?
Hold this.
More after the break.
Today's Chrissy question in the chill chair is, if you couldn't spend any money, what's the best Christmas present you could give?
For my mom, I'd probably have to give her, a day where I did all the jobs in the house.
I'd give my parents breakfast in bed and probably scrambled eggs and coffee.
Give them all the love that I have. I'd make, like, my own little picture frame, and on the back I'd write the note saying Happy Merry Christmas.
I would take the most nicest flowers from the garden with a picture frame of the whole family.
I would give my mum and dad and my sisters and brothers a great kiss and tell them how much I love them.
And that's the word out there from the chill chair. Merry Christmas. That is really sweet. Some great ideas there. And now a gift from me to you, Primates Forever.
That's it for Marsupilami. It was good to see him again.
Yes. Pooh, you're a star.
We'll be back after the break.
The star of Christmas.
Welcome back to a special Christmas episode of Saturday Disney. Right now we're heading to a Christmas Cruella.
Oh, really? Cruella doesn't look so sure. Stick around after the break, a bit of craft. Welcome back to some Christmas craft.
Well, that's
Now, these things are easy. All you need is a pipe cleaner.
You got to show them what we're making.
What are we making?
Well, they're Christmas
Ta-da!
Trees. They're lovely Christmas trees.
Candy trees.
You can use, now, you can use a bit of licorice, or you can use some chocolate bars as well.
Either.
So, what you need is pipe cleaners, green, preferably,
yes,
because it's a Christmas tree and all Christmas trees are green. We all know
all
that.
Trees are, you know,
not all green. Not all of them.
No, no. Okay, go on.
But that's getting technical.
Little stars to stick on top, so they're just cardboard cutouts.
Didn't know about the stars.
Oh, what are you supposed to? Well, you can make angels if you want.
Oh, yeah, I was making trees.
Okay.
Anyway, you get a fat pen.
Or a finger.
Or your finger.
And or two fingers.
Or, well, it depends on how fat you want your tree to be.
Right.
And then you wind it around.
Like that.
And you end up with a bit of a tree, like that.
Yeah.
And then you grab your well, if you're going to go chocolate.
Oh, I'm going chocolate.
I'll go lolly.
I'm going chocolate too.
And then you just stick it in.
Oh, and then you have to make sure that it sits right.
Yeah, make sure it sticks. There you go. And you put a star on top.
Star on top. And this is what you can give your friends, because you know how you like to give your friends something little for Christmas?
Yeah.
This is it.
It's a really good idea.
What happened to your tree?
I think you've got to wind quite well.
But we won't be giving you candy trees because you're all the way over there, but we can give you a cartoon.
We can. Cruella is about to be paid a visit by a couple of Christmas spirits. Do you think Cruella has met a match?
Mm.
I beg your... Was that an answer?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for my present.
That's all right. Made myself one too.
Stick around after the break. I catch up with Steve McCann, a BMX champion. Australia's up-and-coming superstars. At only 18, he is in the top five in his field in the world. But we've got to meet him in his office. Thank you for joining us.
No worries. Good to be here.
Thank you. What does it take to be in the top five in the world in BMX?
Dedication, I guess. I don't know. I just had a lot of fun with my riding, and you know, kept going to the skate parks and going to little competitions and stuff. And I guess it all just eventuated. Have some fun.
When did you start riding?
When I was about 11 years old, I had my first competition, I think. But I've been riding all my life, you know, in the streets, up the gutters, you know, like all little kids do, and just having fun on your bike is the best part about it.
How does your bike now differ from, say, your first BMX?
Well, that's a good question. I guess things just get a lot stronger, you know, your wheels get a lot stronger, you've got 48 spokes instead of 36, you know, you've got stronger three-piece cranks, just stronger pedals, everything's just a little bit more expensive and strong enough to last the distance.
Is it still a toy to you, or is it now a machine?
It's a finely tuned machine. No, it's actually, I don't know, it's still just a toy. It's fun to play around on, and you know, it's just a bicycle, so you know, you take it like that, and it's not a job, so you know, it's a bike. Well, my decision sucks, yeah, but
there's heaps of different types of competition for bike riders. Like you've got flatland, vert,
street.
Dirt,
you've been
street.
Doing your research. I've been
hey,
impressed.
Oh, I know
yeah,
my bikes, yep, man.
You like it. That's good. Now, there's a lot of distance. I usually ride dirt and street, but dirt's my specialty, and street I'm sort of learning. And vert I ride a little bit, but that's pretty scary. You know, if you crash on that sort of stuff, you're going to be out for a while. So I sort of stay away from it.
Do you get taught how to ride?
No, you don't actually get taught how to ride, but you know, you have all your friends there, and you know, progression is one of the biggest things about our sport through word of mouth and you know, trial and error. So I guess in Woodward, when I tried the double backflip, I learned them into foam, and then there's a thing called the res mat, which is a hard plastic mat with you know, a hard base foam underneath it, so it gives a little bit, and you know, you can still ride on it. So as you try things on that, you know, if you crash on it, it's slippery as well, so you won't grip, and that's how you break things when you know, you fall on like dirt, for example. If you fall on dirt, you're not going to keep sliding, you're going to stop. So on the res mat, you sort of keep sliding, and it helps you from you know, impact and all that sort of stuff. So
does it also make a big difference if you're fully padded up?
Yeah.
You're obviously going to give things a lot more effort than you would have if...
Well, yeah, when you got all your pads on, you feel like a bit of a Terminator. It's good in a way, like you crash and, you know, you got all your pads on, you don't really get hurt, but then if you don't wear your pads, you know, you come off with scabs and, you know, sore, and all the time, you know, you'll just be sore all day. So at the same time, if you wear your pads, you don't, you're not sore the next day, you live to ride another day, so...
Well, we are glad you've lived to ride another day.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for talking to us.
No worries. Have some fun. Well, my decision sucks to you, but
man, that is some crazy, crazy stuff. Now, before the girls had their chocolates on their trees, my chocolate, my tree. What do you reckon? I don't know if it works. Hang on. Oh, no, get some leaves in it. Not too cool. Anyway, let's get back to Dalmatians.
No tree is complete without just a few presents around the bottom. Stick around because we have a special Transfreezers Christmas episode after this break.
On a freezing moonlit night, three scientists were working in the laboratory on a top-secret project to invent the world's first unmeltable ice cream, when suddenly...
What's happening?
I feel strange.
Oh, but this tastes good.
The experiment triggered a chemical reaction that transformed the scientists into ice cream-powered problem solvers. Four flavors. Girl Sunday. Scoop. From that day forth, they became the Transfreezers.
Transfreezers, since our Christmas tree is essentially an ice cream cone turned upside down
and painted green,
so it is. Why don't we turn it the right way up, fill it with ice cream, and eat it?
But then we'd have nothing to put our Christmas presents under.
Oh. Double scoop. What you lack in intelligence, common sense, and complete rational thinking, you certainly make up for in... characteristics opposite to those.
Why, thank you, Four Flavors.
That'll be the cone phone. What's our mission, Four Flavors?
See this line of children behind me waiting to have their photo taken with Santa?
Yes.
Well, they are about to be bitterly disappointed because Santa has gone missing. Let's get to work, Transfreezers.
Are you sure these missing person signs are going to work?
Well, I think the message is pretty clear. Missing. One plumpish man in red suit with excessive facial hair. If found, please contact the Transfreezers on the cone phone.
I guess all we can do now is wait. If we can't find our missing Santa, we'll simply have to lure him with a trap.
How do we trap a Santa Claus?
With milk and cookies, of course. And a tape recording of fake reindeer noises.
The missing Santa is nowhere in sight. It appears our trap has failed to...
trap.
If only the recording of fake reindeer noises didn't sound so much like... cows mooing. Do you really think the children will believe that I am Santa Claus?
Well, considering we have no viable alternative, Girl Sunday, I think we ought to at least try the idea, however crazy or doomed to fail it may seem.
Here I go.
Not you're a girl.
Oh, children are a lot smarter than they used to be.
Look, here's Santa Claus. He's back from lunch.
Ho, ho, ho. Deck the halls with boughs of holly, Transfreezers. We've saved the day again.
There's nothing like spreading the festive Christmas spirit.
Transfreezers, are you ready?
If you think that sounds ridiculous, tune in next time for the Transfreezers.
See, he'd gone to lunch. He wasn't missing.
No, even Santas have to have lunch now and then.
What's that? Gosh,
I'm warming up my fingers for my double dog dare.
After the break.
Now it's time for Double Dog Dare.
Well done.
Nicely timed.
Nice. Last week I did Mel to do this.
Mel,
yes.
I dare you.
Do you have a right after that?
To do some origami.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's a good one.
I've done that since I was this high.
Right now, so there you have it. Now, we thought you might need a little bit of help, so
we brought
Michael in to show you how it's done.
Well, it's quite complex, isn't it, Michael? Hi.
Hello, hello.
What is origami to start?
It's the art of paper folding, basically, and that's the important part, folding the paper.
So things like these boxes here, no scissors have been used.
That's correct.
That's amazing. And there's some really cool stuff too. Look, this is one of my favourites. This is the snapping crocodile.
That's right, crocodile.
We got lips.
Birdies.
And there's some really cute little Santas and also frogs.
That's right. Today we're going to do a jumping frog.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Hey, well, clear the way.
Clear the way.
Show us how it's done.
All right. Let's start with our paper white side up. We're going to fold this bottom edge up to the top in half, like so.
Go, Mel, go.
Okay. Orientate it to look like an eye. Mm-hmm. Fold this top edge here down to the right-hand side.
Down to the right-hand side.
Like so.
It's very fiddly.
It is. And unfold.
Yes.
Same edge down to the left-hand side to make the second crease.
So it's just following folding patterns.
Exactly.
Are there books that teach you this stuff?
Lots of books.
Yeah, because how do you remember?
That's right. Turn it over. Okay, take the top 2 points of that X and fold them down to the bottom 2 points.
I hope you guys are taking notes out there.
I keep having to turn it on its side.
That's...
just makes it easier.
It does.
Yes?
Turn over again.
Yes.
Pop the middle.
Pop.
Bang.
That's it. Wow. Bring these two edges down like so. Yes. And another finger to squash the top bit. We're just collapsing on the creases you've already made. And there we are. That's the top of the frog.
Oh, mine's got a blunt
nose.
That's fine.
That's a new species of frog.
That's right.
What we have here is the baseline. So we're going to take this flap here on the left as a leg, and we're going to fold it up so that it sticks over the edge to form the little front leg.
Mm-hmm.
Do the same on the right-hand
side. Well, it needs two legs, doesn't it?
That's you can see it taking shape.
Probably needs four legs.
Do you think? Well, we haven't got to that yet.
Take this bottom edge and fold it up to that baseline.
But you're right. If it's a frog. Yes.
Well done.
Nice.
Okay, left and right points. We're going to make them meet in the centre, just at that base point there.
Uh-huh.
So bring the left-hand side over.
Is that cheating if you keep turning it around? Are you supposed to do everything central?
No, it's not actually. It's more natural to fold away from yourself.
Really? Oh. Well, there you go.
Instinct.
So I'm just a natural folder?
All right.
Excellent.
You'll be whipping up one of these before you know where you are.
Oh, yeah. Right. Yes.
All right, back legs. We start at the bottom left corner and we fold this out from the bottom left corner right up to that centre.
Right up.
Getting close.
So, same on the right-hand side.
Yep.
Almost. Well done. Whole thing in half, right through that centre point.
Oh,
bottom to top.
Frog flexibility.
And then we've got our frog.
And
I can see a frog
there.
Coming.
It's going to be a frog.
It's going to be a frog. Can it jump?
It's going to be a frog. You wait.
And turn over.
Turn over. Woo! Yay. Oh, and then we flip.
Ah! Well done.
Thanks, Michael. Well done, Mel.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Good work.
No, have you got a dare for Mel? Oh, Mel, have you got a dare for dare?
Oh, yes, I do.
Come on, I can give her another dare.
You get another one. You get it twice.
I dare you to swim a lap of every stroke in the pool.
Oh, done.
Including butterfly.
Yeah, all right, I'll try.
Thank you again for coming in. That's fantastic.
My pleasure.
We can play with these. You're going to hang around for a cartoon?
Please.
Excellent. Here it is, Mickey's Mix-Up. Major stuff up, Mickey. Be careful who you fax. See you, Michael. Thanks. There goes the origami guy. But we have another artiste. It is Adam Browning. He's from New Norfolk in Tassie. He's done some terrific Christmas drawings for us. They're our Chrissy present. There's Goofy. We have Max. We've got Jafar from Aladdin. And, of course, Genie from Aladdin. They are terrific drawings, Adam. Thanks very much. Here are your prizes.
Snack time is going to be so much fun with this fantastic prize pack from Mistral. The pack includes the all-new Mr. Slurpee, great for making ice-cold Slurpees this summer, as well as the Igloo ice cream maker, pastry chef, hot dog maker, and popcorn popper. And to celebrate the video release of 102 Dalmatians, you have won a fabulous prize pack, which includes a 102 Dalmatians pillow, a blanket, a t-shirt, plus lots of other great Disney prizes. You've also won a sushi pack, plus lots more. Congratulations!
We hope you enjoy all those, Adam. If you guys would like to write to us, this is the address. Saturday Disney, Letter of the Week, Locked Bag 8777, Eastwood, New South Wales 2122. Don't forget, name, age, address and telephone number on the back of the envelope. And remember to take a photograph of what you're sending in for a keepsake, because we can't send it back. Stick around, after the break, Daniel tackles gridiron.
G'day guys, so hey Phil, how are you mate?
G'day Daniel, how are you?
Good everyone, this is Phil Hunt, the head coach of the Southern Seahawks.
How are you, everyone?
I'm up for a bit of gridiron today, but I don't know the rules, so if you could just fill me in briefly.
Sure, pretty basic rules is you get four tackles to make 10 yards. If you make the 10 yards, you get another four tackles again. If you don't, on your fourth tackle, you can either kick it away and try and get good field position, or you can turn the ball over your opposition. More points you score, the better. 6 points for a touchdown, 3 points for a field goal. Yeah, more touchdowns, the better.
If I was to play, what position would I play?
Daniel, I think you'd be a good wide receiver.
All right.
Yeah? You up for it?
Yeah, let's do it.
Hey!
Are there any safety precautions I need to take, Phil?
Daniel, as long as you wear the correct protective equipment, this sport is as safe as any other, mate.
Let's get it on.
Yeah, let's have a go. I'm sad alone in a boggy marsh, totally motionless,
you're normally the wide receiver, but today you've been replaced by me. What's my job?
Okay, your job as a wide receiver is first you've got to wait until the ball is snapped. As soon as the ball is snapped, you're going to run a route the quarterback has already given to you. You're going to run that route, he's going to throw you the ball, you're going to catch it, hopefully. Okay. Once you've caught it, try and make as many yards as you can, and eventually run to daylight, get into the end zone for a touchdown. After touchdown, give it a touchdown dance.
I'm all over it, no worries. Josh.
Hey, how'd you go, bro?
Oh, I just tried my luck at wide receiver and it was a bit iffy, but I had fun. Now, you're a running back.
That's right.
What's involved there?
Well, a running back, you're going to be basically the prime guy getting the ball, all right? You're going to get the ball and try to move it from the spot that you get it all the way to the end zone. Hopefully in between there, not take too many hits, but we'll see how you go, bro.
All right, thank you. Thanks a lot, Phil. That was great.
Pleasure, Daniel. See you training next week, mate.
Next week? I don't get time to recover.
We want to see the touchdown dance.
No.
Come on, Dan.
I can only do it when I score a touchdown.
Come on. Take it. Work, you're a fast little thing.
It was fun. I enjoyed it.
Oh, we're glad. Heading back to cartoons. Whitewater Don.
Well, at least Daisy's happy, but boy, is she hard work. We'll be right back.
Welcome back.
Welcome back. Have we got another Chrissy cartoon?
Yep, sure do.
Does anyone know what it's called?
Mickey's Christmas Crisis.
Oh, there we go then.
Catch. That is it for Mickey Mouse.
It is mine.
Maybe.
Well, we have a few more days before Christmas because we've got some serious decorating.
We do.
What a lime tree.
You guys have a very Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.